Hello friends, so far we have seen how to run our first Hello World program in Python, and I'm very happy to learn that most of you were able to run it. After understanding your concerns about the platform that you're using, I could get to understand that we would need to use a common platform where we will be running our Python programs. So I would like to know from all of you if you are aware about good Python platforms which helps you executing machine learning programs on mobile platforms like Android or iOS. Please let me know in the comment section. And for now, we would be using Google Colab notebooks, and for visualization of code we would be using pythontutor.com. In this session we would be looking at the basics of Python language. In the coming sessions, I would be covering important points to know about Jupyter Notebook. If you are a new person coming to this channel, please consider subscribing if you have not already yet subscribed. Before we proceed, please open your Jupyter Notebook on Google Colab, and if you are working offline and you are comfortable using it on Anaconda on your own laptop, you can choose to do so. Let's get started with the Python programming language. In our last video, we have used the Google Colab notebook and we have run our first Hello World program. Here, you can see on the screen, we have run the first Python program through the first cell where we had clicked on this button and we were able to see the Hello World printed. You can see this two buttons here, one is saying code and one is saying text. If you click on the code button, you'll be able to see the code buttons getting populated, and if you click on the text button, you'll be able to see that there are the text boxes that are getting populated. There's another way to add the code or text boxes on Google Colab. You can just hover above the cell and you can see the options to add a text or a code block. Right now we'll observe how to start writing in these text boxes. To write a heading here, we will use a hash sign and write our text. The beauty of Google Colab notebooks is whatever you write in the text boxes, you will be able to see directly on the right side of your cell. Now to add a code block, you can click here and you can see a code block appears. There is another way if you want to use, you can just use the backticks and this is how your code will look like. For an example, let us try to see how our Hello World program would look if we insert it as code in our text. This feature really helps data scientists to communicate their findings to all stakeholders, even if they are not from technical background. For an example, if you see I'm speaking and writing it on this text cell and you are getting my message communicated well. This is the beauty of Jupyter Notebooks. Now, let me walk you through our topics that we will try to cover in this as well as the upcoming sessions, but not necessarily in this particular sequence. We would start with variables and the different data types that are available in Python. It's important to understand them. Primarily, there are data types, namely string, integer, and float. We are going to explore them. Then we will look at different operators. Then we will look at string formatting, simple operations that Python performs over different strings. In the meantime, I will also show you what different errors that you might be seeing. Conditions, loops, functions, classes and their objects, dictionaries, modules and packages. This is something that I think we will be able to cover in this session as well as the upcoming sessions. Please remember, this is not the exact sequence, but we will be covering these topics in details. Now I think it is the right time to introduce to you a very wonderful website which I use to understand how the code looks visually. Let us again start with our Hello World program. Here, you will be able to print output section. Although it is written very small, but you will be able to see your output here. Whatever memory is being utilized in your program, you will be shown below, that is below the frames and objects section. For the Hello World program, Python doesn't use any kind of memory, so it will be empty. You can store your values in the entities that we call the variables. These variables help you enhance your coding in a very, very nice ways. We will see an example. So let me give you an example. If I want to print name rather than print hello world, I would like to print hello and my name.
I will store my name in a variable which I will call your name. You can insert any value in this variable and it will print it. You can pause this video here and why don't you give it a try for yourself? Maybe you would like to see your name here. Please try it for yourself. Were you able to see something here? Please notice this global frame here that has come and you see the variable name that we used. There is also the value that we have used that is stored here. It might not look like a big deal for you at this moment, but trust me, this is going to be something that will really help you to visually see the code that you are writing. And this will prove to be a boon when you are doing complex programs. Many of you would be attempting for coding hackathons or big coding problems, or maybe there is something called as ACM-ICPC. Many programmers really compete there for very, very good coding programs. So this is something that will prove to be very useful for you. Now we have seen the way the variables are used. Let us formally define them in our Google Colab notebook. Variables are something that I call the buckets to store different values. And unlike other programming languages, you need not tell Python in advance about the type of value the variable is expected to store. This is what something makes Python really unique from the bunch of programming languages that are available. So the type of variable or the data type of the variable is decided automatically. This does not mean that Python variables do not have a type. There is a function called type that is used to find out what is the data type of the variable. And I hope this is not confusing to you. So to clear your confusion, let us again use the same example of the variable that we used. And I'm sorry if you don't like to repeat things, but please hang on. We are doing this to understand a very important concept here. While defining the variables, there are a few rules to be taken care of, but I will tell you the most important one. There should not be any kind of space in the variable names, and you will see the syntax error like the one shown here. Now, as I told you already that there is a function called type in Python which will tell us the data type of the variable. So let us try to find out the type of the variable your name, and guess what? You will see it to be a string. In computer science, the sequence of characters enclosed in the inverted comma is called a string, or simply a sequence of characters is called a string. Now I will show you the different types available, that is int and the float. Please look carefully at the screen to understand how the Python recognizes them as data types. We have already seen the string variable. Now, I would like to encourage you to please see it visually on the website pythontutor.com. And I would say it again that the simple exercise might seem trivial to you, but I know the importance of the simple tasks. It will develop the proper understanding of the coding that you are doing. And believe me, I was not taught this way. And if I would have been taught it this way, my life would have been better. And majority of the people do not post their tutorials on the internet in a way like this. So keeping the long-term benefit in your mind, kindly go through this. And you see these variables are populated in the global frame in Python memory. This is how it works in Python. Now, after we have understood this, we will have a look at the functions. So far, we have used two inbuilt functions of Python. One is print and another is type. Do you know that we can create our own functions? To create it, the syntax will be shown on the screen. And functions are used to create a repetitive task that we want to do every time and we do not want to code it again and again. So I would like to introduce to you something called as indentation. Indentation is something that Python works on. Unlike few other languages which uses curly braces, Python uses the tab or five spaces from the left to make a code block a part of something that is called as the parent. Indentation means giving a space of 5 or a tab. It will look like this. And what does it mean? It means whatever code block has been indented is a part of the parent. Here, this function will be able to print the type of the variable that we are sending. Now, the question is, how do we call it? Let us first make a variable outside this function which will hold that value which we are interested to pass. Let us give it a name, argument for function. You can feed it any value you may want to pass, and this will be used to call the function. Now, to call the function, use its name and pass the variable to the function that we have just created. Before calling the function, please make sure that it has already been executed, otherwise you will see an error saying that the function does not exist. So you can see that a value is printed in the output section of the code. But you know what? To demonstrate you the way a function should be called, I printed inside the function, which is not ideal. So from now, we will be using the ideal things in our code. For every function that we write, we should just take the value, process that value, and return it without printing anything when we are writing the production level code. So we will fix it, and you can see that the class label is now removed. And when I write code in my day-to-day life, I always make sure that whatever function I'm creating, I write the doc strings to support the users that might be using my code. So whenever someone looks at my code, they should be very easily be able to understand what this piece of code does even without looking at it. So the sections of the doc string should be, first line should be explaining what this piece of code does, then we tell what argument it accepts, and then we tell what does this function returns. Now we will try to visualize the execution of this code so that it is clear what happens behind the scenes. Now this is our website pythontutor.com. And we will try to visually see what it really does in the background. Let us try to see what happens behind the scenes. So this is the argument that we are going to pass for the function. And here we are going to call our function. Now, let us store this value that we are going to get in a variable. So let us call it output variable. Let us put underscore. Now, let us try to visualize it. First step, we will define the function. So you can see inside the global frame, this function, that is the name of the function, it has been created as a function. Now, when we execute the next line, it will create a new memory for argument for function, that is, and it will also store the variable, the value of the variable, that is 10. Now, we are going to call this function again. So name of the function and argument 1. So argument 1 stores 10. So you see, this is not the global frame. This is a new section that has been created. So for every function that we create, a new value section or the local variables or a new section gets created inside the memory, which stores the local variables for the function. So you see, when I try to return this, it returns with some value. So you can see there is a return value associated, and you see just down below there are so many things happening, and you can see this absolute, we are not going to go into the detail at this moment, but you see this is the int class that is supposed to be returned, and this is returned. Now when we see the next line, we see the output variable, and the output variable is inside the global frame, and this output variable now stores the instance of the int variable. So you see that behind everything that we do, there is a big sequence of steps that we see that is being followed.